This is not India caught in the clutches of a defensive non-aligned posture. This is a new India.
If there are problems in the Middle East,
China is challenging the US dominance. The new India doesn't succumb to international pressure.
Act East, Link West, Neighborhood First, Connect Central Asia.
Or the philosophy of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, the permanent membership of the African Union.
The blunders committed in the past, taking the Kashmir issue to the UN.
The abrogation of Article 370.
And 2019 Balakot airstrike. China's construction of border villages.
India, Middle East, Europe Economic Corridor, IMEEC. And to counter Hambantota, India is developing the Colombo port.
Chandrayaan 3 demonstrated the
Dr. Ambedkar's vision of India first.
The West has burnt its fingers by playing the Islamic card.
Misuse of freedom of speech in several countries, distorting its history and promoting anti-India agenda because they think that they have failed or are corrupt.
Making the global inequalities even bigger. Epics like Ramayana and Mahabharat.
Hard work that is involved in making India that is more Bharat. Since this book is written by a sitting minister, that too in an election year, no government is perfect. No leader is perfect. Dr. S Jaishankar, a seasoned diplomat, has been India's External Affairs Minister since 2019. Having served India on the international stage in various capacities, he has navigated the world of diplomacy for over four decades. What if you could gain access to his wealth of knowledge? Well, actually, you can. He has poured his extensive experience in international relations into his latest book, Why Bharat Matters, which is essentially a collection of 11 interconnected essays. If you are looking for a book that presents the message of a new India, then this book is a good read. You need a basic understanding of geopolitics to make the most out of this book. Let us look at the important points raised by Dr. Jaishankar in the book.
Our world is highly connected in many ways, such as technology, trade, communication, and travel. What happens in one part of the world can have ripple effects that reach far and wide. For example, if there are problems in the Middle East, it can make it hard to get oil. That could make the price of oil go up. India needs a lot of oil from other countries to run things like cars and factories. So, if oil costs more, it can make everything else cost more too, like transportation and goods in shops. This shows how things happening far away can make life more expensive here in India. Since global events can directly affect our everyday lives, hence it is important to stay informed about global issues, trends, and developments.
The world is going through a churn. China is challenging the US dominance. There are economic uncertainties everywhere. Technology is rapidly advancing. And climate change is a big worry. So the current geopolitical situation is experiencing significant change and upheaval. There are post-COVID challenges. Geopolitical tensions are running hot. And conflicts are ongoing in many parts of the world. The rivalry between major powers for influence and dominance on the global stage is adding to the geopolitical complexities. Increasing disagreements and hostility between countries are raising concerns about Cold War 2.0.
Amidst this state of flux and turmoil in the global arena, what has caught global attention is India's rise as a power. Dr. Jaishankar explains in the book how India is adjusting to the unpredictability and transformations occurring across the globe. You must have noticed that India is diversifying its diplomatic and economic partnerships. On one hand, India procures S-400 missile defense systems from Russia, and on the other hand, it acquires MH-60 helicopters and MQ-9B armed drones from the US. It cracks a lucrative oil deal with Russia as well as providing humanitarian aid to Ukraine.
The new India doesn't succumb to international pressure. Rather than taking sides, India focuses on de-escalation and solutions through diplomacy. It collaborates with Israel in the defense sector and also invests in Iran's Chabahar port to gain access to Central Asia. It participates with the US in Quad and I2U2, as well as engages with Russia and China in BRICS and SCO. This addresses Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar's worry about India alienating much of the world. Instead of the rigid stance of non-alignment, India now prefers strategic autonomy.
Pulling off the Herculean diplomatic balance between the US and Russia and dehyphenation between Israel and Palestine would give you an idea of how India is managing complex international relationships and leveraging opportunities for collaboration. By simultaneously engaging with multiple nations, India is deftly expanding its network of alliances, which, of course, would enable it to navigate geopolitical uncertainties better. Act East, Link West, Neighborhood First, Connect Central Asia. India is pursuing all of those policies simultaneously.
By going beyond traditional confines, India is opening up new vistas for itself. This is not India caught in the clutches of a defensive non-aligned posture. This is a new India that engages in multiple directions, balances competitive relationships, and shapes the global agenda. What Dr. Jaishankar refers to as multiple engagements simultaneously with major power centers. Of course, keeping national interests in mind.
As the reordering of existing systems is taking place, India is being seen differently on the world stage. India's global image has gone up and perception about India is changing. A lot of factors contribute to this improved reputation and standing. A nice example would be its reputation for being a trusted collaborator and a credible partner. The world saw how, under the Vaccine Maitri initiative, India assisted other countries by providing millions of doses of COVID-19 vaccines. So when you contribute to a better world and treat the international community as a family, it obviously changes the mindset of the global community.
Treating the world as a family, or the philosophy of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, is nothing but Sabka Saath Sabka Vikas being applied to foreign policy. That is the reason why India is occupying a greater mind space in today's world and being hailed as a Vishwa Mitra, or the friend of the world. India's push towards the permanent membership of the African Union was one of the major highlights of India's grand G20 success. It demonstrates India's commitment to providing a voice to the concerns of the Global South.
At the same time, India's resolve to advance its interests can be seen in its swift response in the Sri Lankan economic crisis, strong response to Pakistan via 2016 surgical strike and 2019 Balakot airstrike, an apt response to Maldivian misadventures. Staying away from the RCEP, doing away with Article 370, and sailing away with technology conveys a sense of forward movement with a nationalistic outlook. The new India doesn't shy away from messaging its intentions and projecting its image positively. It is increasingly promoting its interests by owning its ability to practice strategic silence at the right moment and confidently articulating its position when needed. Thus, India is moving ahead with stronger nationalism plus enthusiastic internationalism.
There has been a rebalancing in the weight of the players in the world order. The US remains a superpower, although its dominance has reduced. China aspires to fill the power vacuum, while Russia is growing stronger despite sanctions. Amidst all this, India is quickly rising to join the ranks of dominant powers. Today, India is an important player in the multipolar world. The Indo-Pacific region is becoming the geopolitical and economic center of gravity in present times. It encompasses the Indian Ocean, the Western and Central Pacific Ocean. This region is emerging as a theater of competition due to its vital maritime trade routes and natural resources. India is well positioned to be a key actor in shaping the strategic dynamics in the Indo-Pacific region due to its geographical location, growing economy, rising international profile, military capabilities, expanding global footprint, and diplomatic influence.
The China issue is also mentioned in the book. China's disregard for established norms and agreements concerning India's sovereignty and territorial integrity is well known. Steps are being taken to safeguard India's core interests, and India will stand its ground firmly when national security is challenged. However, diplomatic negotiations will also be pursued to prevent tensions with China from escalating. Challenges persist in the relationship, such as China's absurd territorial claims, border disputes, diplomatic tensions, opposition to India's membership in the NSG, and blocking of Indian proposals to sanction terrorists at the UN. China's construction of border villages, transgressions in the Indian Ocean, and violations of India's sovereignty under the CPEC, a part of the BRI, is the culmination of failing to counter its rising influence over the years. India's response to China's actions across the border includes all-weather connectivity through infrastructure development and fortifying border defenses with robust troop deployments.
Another significant development is India-Middle East-Europe Economic Corridor, IMEEC, which will connect Asia with the Persian Gulf and Europe, serving as a counter to China's Belt and Road Initiative. With China's growing maritime power, India is expanding its presence in the Indian Ocean. To counter China's control of Gwadar, India is leveraging Iran's Chabahar port. And to counter Hambantota, India is developing the Colombo port. Further, India is enhancing diplomatic engagement and security cooperation with regional countries and offering alternatives to Chinese investments. Initiatives like Sagar will help to mitigate China's growing influence and assertiveness in the region.
Technological advancements like artificial intelligence, big data, robotics, and biotechnology can change the geopolitical power balance. Countries are competing with each other in technology. In this digital age, new kinds of conflicts are happening, like cyber warfare. Countries are engaging in tech wars to become the best in technology and protect national interests. India is recognizing the emerging challenges in the digital realm, such as cyber threats and information warfare, and is gearing up to compete and succeed in the fast-changing digital world.
The book paints a picture of India ascending the global hierarchy. The world is getting accustomed to India's rapid economic growth, rising cultural influence, nimble diplomacy, and increasing hard and soft power. This aligns with Dr. Ambedkar's vision of India first and emphasis on building our own strength. Naturally, all of this increases India's capability to assume greater responsibilities and make stronger contributions worldwide. India's contributions to UN peacekeeping efforts demonstrate its commitment to promoting global peace, security, and stability. The world is at a critical juncture where significant changes are taking place. At this turning point, India occupies more mind space than ever before and has become indispensable in key global debates.
The book touches upon the blunders committed in the past, such as rejecting the UNSC permanent seat, overlooking the China threat, maintaining an extremely idealistic and impractical outlook towards the West, taking the Kashmir issue to the UN, and neglecting border infrastructure. These are termed legacy complications, and attempts are being made to rectify them. Apart from mentioning Mr. Nehru's legacy challenges, the book discusses Sardar Patel's legacy and his efforts towards national integration. Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee's struggle against balkanization and efforts towards integrating and mainstreaming Jammu and Kashmir are also discussed.
We know that the abrogation of Article 370 is an important step towards a strong and united India. It opens doors for greater socio-economic development and newer opportunities for Kashmir. It will prevent external powers from taking advantage of the Kashmir issue by perpetuating socio-political divisions within the country. Given our troublesome Western neighbor, this step will allow the government to carry out effective counter-terrorism operations and prevent separatist sentiments from thriving. It will open up Kashmir for increased investment, economic growth, and development.
The West has burnt its fingers by playing the Islamic card. In order to diminish the influence of the Soviet Union, the Western world, led by the United States, supported various Islamic groups and movements through military aid, funding and training. However, in the long term, this led to unforeseen consequences. Negative repercussions include the rise of extremism, threats to global security, conflicts, and humanitarian crisis. That's why India firmly stands against terrorism. By exposing Pakistan's cross-border terrorism, engaging in counter-terrorism diplomacy at the United Nations, and sending clear messages through surgical and airstrikes, India effectively communicates its zero-tolerance approach towards terrorism.
Dr. Jaishankar also points out the misuse of freedom of speech in several countries, including the UK and Canada. The inability to curb the flames of separatism and anti-India narratives in foreign countries is being countered, and firm diplomatic measures are being taken as and when required. Another major challenge in this age is disinformation and misrepresentation of facts. The New India pushes back strongly against downplaying its achievements, distorting its history, and promoting anti-India agenda aimed at exploiting societal divisions. This is a recognition of the fact that national security is a priority. It is a 24/7 exercise.
India's ability to observe global trends, anticipate, and then respond effectively is increasing. Its strengthened capacity and readiness to respond to unforeseen contingencies owe a lot to its pragmatic policies and adept diplomacy. Dr. Jaishankar states that a good foreign policy must also make a difference at home. An example would be the Vande Bharat mission, the largest recorded evacuation exercise in history, successfully bringing millions of Indians back from multiple countries by air, sea and land in extremely stressful situations. This requires skillful negotiation, interventions at various levels, and the management of exceptionally complicated logistics. What comes in handy is the art of nurturing relationships over the years and effectively utilizing them in challenging circumstances. Operations Ganga in Ukraine, Devi Shakti in Afghanistan, and Kaveri in Sudan are just a few such examples.
India is no longer an underperformer. It is the fastest growing major economy. Currently, it is the fifth largest economy and is heading towards becoming the third largest in the world in a few years. India is the world's largest democracy with close to 18% of the global population. India is well known for its robust electoral system, which lets people participate in the governance process through free and fair elections. Over the years, India has had smooth power transitions between different political groups, showing how stable and mature its democracy is. India has a significant demographic advantage due to a large population of young people. That means there is a big chance for the economy to grow, for new ideas to come up, and for people to work more efficiently. The presence of over 30 million Indians living and working abroad shows how important the Indian diaspora is globally. Indian expatriates play a big part in the economies of the countries they live in. India encourages new ideas, helps people learn new skills, and supports those who want to start their own businesses. It also attracts investments from all over the world, which helps India grow economically.
The gap between developed and developing countries is widening, which deepens the North-South divide in terms of economic opportunities and resources. Developed nations often engage in unfair trade practices and exploit resources and labor in developing countries, making the global inequalities even bigger. India is working to reduce risks in the global economy by promoting stability, transparency, and fair trade practices. It is aligning itself with other countries that share similar values and interests while preserving its unique identity. To mitigate risks and dependencies, there's a push to diversify supply chains and production processes, reducing reliance on just one place.
Significant divisions within societies around the world have led to more social unrest. People do not trust old institutions as much because they think that they have failed or are corrupt. India sees its many cultures, languages, religions, and traditions as strong points. showing how it can stay united even with lots of differences. The country is moving forward with a clear plan to prioritize its own needs first and not being afraid to push its own way of doing things. We are witnessing India becoming stronger as a nation and experiencing a cultural resurgence.
India is embracing progressive thinking and leveraging technology while also preserving its rich heritage and cultural traditions. It is promoting traditional practices such as yoga and millets as part of efforts to promote health, sustainability, and cultural heritage. Epics like Ramayana and Mahabharat are treasure troves of wisdom. We can learn about good governance or Ram Rajya and building a rules-based order from Ramayana, and statecraft and diplomacy from the Mahabharat. In every chapter, you would find Dr. Jaishankar referring to events from the Ramayana and showing us their application in foreign policy.
India celebrated its 75th Independence Day in 2021 and will be celebrating its 100th Independence Day in 2046. The 25-year period from 2021 to 2046 has been termed the Amrit Kal. Efforts are being made to ensure that India at 100 becomes better in every field compared to India at 75. Boosting India's self-sufficiency under Make in India and Atmanirbhar Bharat and embracing the digital age or the decade is a step in this direction. A solid digital backbone enabled the government to provide food support to 80 crore people during the pandemic. India's UPI or Unified Payments Interface has made instant and immediate real-time payments possible. It is being used at all levels, from malls to street vendors. Additionally, India is leveraging technology to connect with the world and foster global partnerships, as evidenced by the adoption of UPI by many countries. Moreover, India is known as the world's pharmacy because it plays a significant role in producing medicines, especially generic drugs and vaccines.
In the book, Dr. Jaishankar lists several achievements of the government, such as economic revival after COVID, creating world-class infrastructure under the Gati Shakti initiative, transforming digital governance through the Jam Trinity, and rolling out public welfare schemes, such as Beti Bachao Beti Padhao, Jal Jeevan Mission, Ujwala Scheme, Awas Yojana, Saubhagya Scheme, etc. India's vast potential and capabilities are increasingly recognized and appreciated on the global stage, marking a departure from past perceptions of undervaluation or underestimation. Chandrayaan 3 demonstrated the country's growing prowess in space exploration and technology. So India is transitioning towards a knowledge-based economy, emphasizing innovation, education, and technological advancements as drivers of economic growth and development.
Climate change is the biggest problem today. It brings a lot of challenges like hotter temperatures, extreme weather events, sea level rise, and environmental degradation. Fixing climate change needs everyone to work together, from local places to whole countries. Everyone needs to team up to find answers and ways to deal with climate change, sharing what they know and have. While climate change poses challenges, it also creates opportunities for collaboration, innovation, and economic growth. By investing in ways to fight climate change, countries can tackle it and make things better for the future. India is working hard to switch to clean and renewable energy sources.
Foreign policy plays a crucial role in advancing a nation's development goals and aspirations. It helps a country connect with other countries, which can open up new markets for businesses by negotiating trade agreements and reducing trade barriers. Skillful diplomacy and negotiation in foreign policy can lead to favorable outcomes for a country, such as securing beneficial trade deals and gaining access to critical resources and technologies. Through foreign collaboration and partnerships, countries can acquire capital investment, advanced technologies, and best practices from abroad, which can drive economic growth, innovation, and development. For example, India's development in metro systems, space exploration, and nuclear energy has been facilitated by collaboration with foreign partners.
In this book, you can see what really goes on behind the scenes to build a better India. It is like seeing the hard work that is involved in making India that is more Bharat. Since this book is written by a sitting minister who is intelligent and highly articulate, that too in an election year, it is understandable that we can't expect it to contain the shortcomings of the government. It is natural for it to contain a lot of praise for Prime Minister Modi's leadership. The objective perspective is that no government is perfect. No leader is perfect. Humans are bound to commit mistakes. Searching for a perfect leader who makes no mistakes is futile. We just have to go by the less imperfect choice. Anyway, this is the end of the video. These were Dr. Jaishankar's thoughts on New India in his latest book, Why Bharat Matters. Feel free to share your thoughts in the comments. We'll be back soon with insights from another book. I hope you found the video useful. Thank you for your time.